Praise the Lord. Good morning, good morning, good morning to the Powerhouse Church of God. It's good to be assembled with the people of God and those that are gathering at this time. Again, this is the day that the Lord has made. And we will rejoice and be glad in it. We also want to welcome those that are joining in with us today and will join with us from social media. So we welcome you to the Powerhouse Church of God service today. May God's blessings and provisions be upon each household that looks in today, as well as those that assemble with us today. Amen. It's good to see those that have assembled and those that are yet assembling with us today. Sister Simon's going to come with our scripture reading today. I've got to open up with prayer. Father, we thank you for this day, another gift from you, and we're thankful and grateful. It's another opportunity to get closer to you. Yeah, it's an opportunity for those that don't know you to come to know you. And that coming to know you is a work of your Spirit. And so, Holy Spirit, we yield to you and your divine power to use everything that you enable us to do to reach souls that are in need of the good news of the kingdom of God. To reach those and touch and minister to those that are in need of the comforting presence of your name. For those that are in need of your healing power for their bodies, for their souls, for their minds, for their lives, for their relationship. Father, you're able to do more than we can imagine. Yeah, your word says exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. And so we yield to the work and ministry of Holy Spirit who helps us to be instruments of your work. Be honored and glorified in all that we do today. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Good morning. Truly God is good. Amen?
Amen.
All the time.
God is good.
In every season. For every reason. He's still God. He's God alone. There is none like him. He is the sovereign God. Amen. And we've gathered in his name to worship him. Stand to your feet for the reading of the scripture. This morning's scripture is found in Luke chapter 4, verses 14 through 21. Luke 4, 14 through 21. Then Jesus returned to Galilee, filled with the Holy Spirit's power. Reports about him spread quickly through the whole region. He taught regularly in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to the village of Nazareth, his boyhood home, he went as usual to the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read the scriptures. The scroll of Isaiah, the prophet, was handed to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where this was written. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come. He rolled up the scroll, handed it back to the attendant, and sat down. All eyes in the synagogue looked at him intently. Then he began to speak to them. The scripture you've just heard has been fulfilled this very day. The word of the Lord is blessed this morning. Shout out, I'm blessed.
Hallelujah. We are blessed. Amen. Amen. In the city and in the field. And I'm coming and I'm going out. I'm going out and coming in. And Lord, we just give you glory and honor and praise this morning. I'm coming to this house to magnify your name.
Desire.
Oh, new mercies. Thank you, Lord.
Bring souls into the light of the gospel. bring souls and lives into the healing power of your presence. Comfort, O God, for those who are still in heaviness and burdened with the challenges of life. Visit their space, their room, their lives, their hearts, their minds, with your peace, with your joy, with your love, with your comfort, with your presence. Your word says in your presence is fullness of joy. And your joy is unspeakable and full of glory. Your will be accomplished, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. I want to celebrate our praise team, our worship leaders,
amen,
once again.
Amen.
Amen. We appreciate your work, and amen, it's an encouragement to us. Amen. When I look at you, it looks like y'all believe what you're singing. Amen. And I believe it. I'm just saying, you look it too. Amen.
Praise looks good on you.
Yes. To God be the glory. Amen. Yes. To God be the glory. Let me begin this morning with thanks for those that put in the work to celebrate Sister Diane.
Amen.
In the memorial
Amen.
Yesterday.
Amen.
For her sisters.
Yes.
Sister Rebecca's not able to be with us today, so keep her lifted up in your prayers. She's online with us, so we want to thank everyone, the family members in the body of Christ that came alongside the family on yesterday. We had a glorious time.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
It was a memorable time of hearing family members.
Amen.
It means something if people remember your life.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. It suggests that you made deposits in theirs.
Yes.
Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Amen. Thank you, Sister Simon, for reading the scripture today. It's coming from Luke chapter 4. We're going to use that as a launching point for preaching, teaching, encouraging us in the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And here's a scripture that I want to continue to use as an inspiration for these series, this series of messages that the Lord has inspired about us pursuing holiness. Amen. The Church of God is a holiness movement.
Amen.
I don't want us to fall into the humanistic trap of us just being holy and better than everybody else. The God, call of God to holiness is not for us to be better than other folk. His call is for us to be like Him. And that's what His provision is, and His call is for all men. And here it is in 1 Peter 1, verses 15 and 16. I've used this as an inspiration and encouragement to me for quite some time now. You'll find these verses represented in several other places, but here Peter reminds us, but now you must be holy in everything you do. That's verse 15. Just as God who chose you is holy, Then verse 16, for the scriptures say you must be holy because I am holy. Those are words from the heart and the mind and the voice of God that Peter's relating to us in the scriptures. You must be holy because I am holy. I mean, you know, Jesus came so that we could be holy. Yes. He paid the price. He paid the price. And let me begin, and for the little time that I'm going to be before you today, we're going to talk about holy lordship. And the key word is Jesus is Lord. And I pray that we will hear of his lordship in a way that it becomes more prominent for our lives. Is that Jesus is Lord, but it means something even more than him just being our Savior. When we say our Savior, we get the picture that he saved us from our sins so that we can become like him and Father God. He paid the price for our sin. Amen. That's not a small thing. That's a great thing, because we cannot be right with God apart from salvation. His lordship is vital to us so that we can live in this life. Amen. Jesus is Lord so that we can be his representatives here in this realm. Let me say it a different way. Salvation gets us to heaven. Lordship helps us to live here while we're saved. Let me say it again. Receiving Christ as our Savior gives us access and privilege to be a part of the family of God and go to where he is when we die. But his lordship in our lives allows us to live this saved life in this earth realm until we die. Thank you, Sakori. Put that one slide up there. Lord, in the Greek, is kurios. I don't know if you've ever heard that word, but kurios. Now, we're here in New Orleans, and that word comes up during Mardi Gras time, because they've got all kinds of positions and kurios is a Greek word, but it means supreme in authority. Jesus is Lord. And here are two scriptures that emphasize this in the way that we should hear and understand. Romans 10:9, it's up there on the screen. If you all openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Believing that Jesus is Lord is a part of the process of salvation. 1 Corinthians 12:3 is there also. It said, I want you to know that by the Spirit of God, got some background music. Amen. So I want you to know that no one speaking by the Spirit of God will curse Jesus. No one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now those two scriptures are worth studying so that you can appreciate it. But Luke 4:1. Sister Simon read Luke chapter 4 verses 14 through 21. But I want to start with the first two verses of that same chapter from Luke writing for our benefit. Then Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan River, and he was led by the Spirit in the wilderness. This verse is one that follows him having been baptized by John the Baptist. Now the Spirit of the Lord, living God, descended upon him like a dove, is what the scripture says. And now, full of the Holy Spirit, full of the Holy Spirit, full of the Holy Spirit. I'm emphasizing that because I want to make sure that we all appreciate that we all need to be full of the Holy Spirit. And I emphasize full. Amen. We need Holy Spirit filling every area of our lives. And I suggest to you, there's nothing that can't be a part of. And if there is, we need to re-examine. Amen. Verse 2 of Luke chapter, it says, where he was tempted by the devil for 40 days, Jesus ate nothing all that time and became very hungry. You know these verses. Just remember, Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit. That means he had the full power of the Holy Spirit, his nature and his anointing upon his life. And also that verse says he was led of the Holy Spirit into the wilderness. He was led into the wilderness to be tested by the enemy. Amen? And he was tempted for 40 days. And I pause for a reason, because God will allow you to go through some tests. Amen. No believer is exempt from testing. Let me submit to you, as I appreciate it from my walk, the Lord allows you to be tested so that you can know whether you got it or not. You know whether you're trusting him or not, whether you know that the help is with you. God's going to let you see that the Holy Spirit can help you. You don't know until you get tested. I've got a phrase that I use, faith isn't faith until it's tried. For the trying of your faith works patience. It works endurance. Amen. So God allows you to be tested. Jesus was tested here. And then Sister Simon read Luke chapter 4, verse 14. And we're going to go from here to speak for the next few moments about the holy lordship of Jesus Christ. And it's very important for us to pay attention to the lordship of Jesus, his authority, divine authority in the believer's life. Luke chapter 4, Sister Simon read verse 14. Then Jesus returned to Galilee, filled. Reports about him spread quickly through the whole region. He taught regularly in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. And when he came to the village of Nazareth, his boyhood home, he went as usual to the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read the scriptures. The scroll of Isaiah the prophet was handed to him. He unrolled the scroll intently. Then he began to speak. Can you imagine what that moment was like? All those Jewish religious folk who knew the scripture, he picked up the book and read what they've always been reading, and he read it as a young man, and he sat down. And they were all looking at him to see what else he was going to do, and he said, today, hallelujah, the scriptures you've heard has been fulfilled this very day. He was fulfilling the prophecy. Amen? Did I miss verse 19? Let's just put it back up there, because he read that the oppressed will be set free and the time of the Lord's favor has come. And I wanted that because the Lord's favor has come. The Lord has been manifested. He said the scriptures you've heard have been fulfilled this very day. And for the next few moments, let me emphasize how important and valuable it is for us to not only know that Jesus is Lord, live knowing that Jesus is Lord. Amen? Amen. His lordship secures our future with God. Put my other slide in there because I'm going to put two big words up here so that you can recognize why it's important for us to know Jesus as Lord. How many of you ever heard orthodox? Yeah, here's the word orthodoxy. Doxy is a word, is a doctrine, is teaching. Holy teaching, a holy doctrine is orthodoxy. Now, a new word for me is orthopraxy, which means living, holy practice. Orthodoxy must always lead to oxopraxy. Are you following me? Amen. If you got holy doctrine, it ought to lead to holy living. Amen. It's all right to have your Bible and talking it and teaching it, but it ain't nothing unless you're living it. Amen. And so, knowing the word, you have the doctrine, the teaching. You have the word in your hand, but it ought to be in your heart so that you can live it out. So orthodoxy must always lead to orthopraxy. Amen. 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 You must do what you believe. Amen. Let me use the scripture. I'm going to stay in the scriptures for the next few moments and I'm done. And I'm going to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. Let's see how important it is for Jesus' lordship to be real in our lives. Paul writes this to the church at Colossae. And it says the letter is from Paul, chosen by the will of God to be an apostle of Christ Jesus, and from our brother Timothy. And he says in verse 2, we are writing to Paul, and Timothy's writing this letter. We are writing to God's holy people in the city of Colossae, who are faithful brothers and sisters in Christ. May God our Father give you grace and peace. We always pray for you, and we give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And verse 4, he said, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and your love for all of God's people. Jesus as Lord means that you walk by and live by faith. Amen. Amen. Your salvation is based on faith in who Jesus is. Amen. But let me share something. Faith is not just a belief. Faith is action. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. So you must do, amen, what he expects us to do. Faith is evidence which can be seen. God sees faith by our action. Amen. Faith is the evidence of things hoped for. Amen. Love for the people of God. This is what Paul was saying. We have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and your love for all of God's people. When you do love, you're showing faith in God. Amen. So faith is an action. Love for the people of God, the family of God, is evidence of your faith in God. Love is what you do. Amen. Verse 5. Which come from your confident hope of what God has reserved for you in heaven. You have this expectation ever since you first heard the truth of the good news. His lordship secures our future in God. And so we know where we're going when we die. I have a hope. We have a hope within our soul. It's an anchor to our soul. That's one of the songs we sing, right, Sister Patricia? Amen. Amen. But a hope that's within us. It's a bright and shiny day. I don't know all the words. I'd have to grab you a book. But a hope. We have a hope. The same good news that came to you is going out all over all the world, says the word of God here. The same good news that came to you is going out all over the world. It is bearing fruit everywhere by changing lives. Just as it changed your life from the day you first heard and understood the truth about God's wonderful grace. Let me pause for a moment just so that I can remind myself as a pastor and endeavor to teach. We should never stray away from the gospel. Amen. There's a whole lot being taught in the world. You get on your phone and you got everybody with a little snippet on TikTok and Instagram and they got something to say. And Brother Wayne, when I read, I said, who are these people? They got a whole bunch of followers and just saying stuff. But we have to be bearing fruit by changing lives. Just as it changed your life from the day you first heard and understood the truth about God and wonderful grace. Stay in the word and stay in the gospel. The gospel of Jesus Christ changes lives. Don't get caught up with people giving you two steps to do this, three steps to do this, how to get out of a problem by following our program. Preach the gospel. It's Jesus that changes lives. Verse 7 says, you learned about the good news from Epaphras, our beloved co-worker. He is Christ's faithful servant, and he is helping us on your behalf. He has told us about the love for others that the Holy Spirit has given you. The gospel is active and mobile. Amen. Amen. The gospel can change lives, and the gospel goes wherever you go. Amen. 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 If you love the Lord, you don't always have to have a Bible under your arm. Amen. It's good to carry the word with you, but it's better to carry it in here. Amen. Amen. Every now and then you won't have it to refer to or your phone. But the scriptures tell you don't worry about what you're going to say. Amen. Even the scriptures tell you don't worry about to say what you're going to say in the moment you need to say it, because the Holy Spirit will bring it to your remembrance. How many of you ever had the Holy Spirit give you what you needed to say when it needed to be said? Brother Vernon, I've had a few times when the Holy Spirit has given me a word for somebody and I have to go away myself and say, well, I know where it came from, but I'm so shocked that God gave me what I needed to say when I needed to say it. And that just verified the word of God is that the gospel is mobile. That means it can go wherever you are going. Carry the word of God with you. It's alive, it's living, and life-giving. It will change lives. Yeah, and the Holy Spirit is the one who activates and empowers the gospel in and through us. Verse 9 says, so we have not stopped praying for you since we first heard about you. We ask God to give you the complete knowledge of his will and to give you spiritual wisdom and understanding. Amen. That's what this is what I love about following the lead of the Spirit of God. Always trust the Holy Spirit to give you what to say, and when to say it, and how to say it.
Lord, have mercy.
Now, let me submit to you, not everybody's the same. And let me say this as a pastor. And this is for everybody, and I'll look up here. This is for every one of us. I thank God for each one of us. Amen. But not everybody's a genius.
All right. Say that. Say that. Amen.
I try not to come down and look at anybody. I'm picking on you. No, but you've got to let the Holy Spirit give you what to say and how to say it to somebody, because they're not going to be able to receive it like you might talk to somebody else.
Amen. So so true.
Holy Spirit knows who you're talking to.
Amen.
Not only that, he knows where they're at. They may not be able to handle something that you feel like saying. And I don't know if you've ever been in this situation where God gave you something to say and you said it the way he said it, and then you thought about it and said, you know, I was about to say something else. But the Holy Spirit gives you wisdom and understanding, and it comes from his lordship. When Jesus is governing your life, that means you surrender control to him. Enabling production of good fruit. There it is. Orthodoxy produces orthopraxy. Amen. That sounds like a medical term. Is it, sister? Amen. Amen. Good doctrine brings about good practice. This growth in his grace continues to get better and better. Verse 11 of Colossians chapter 1. We're moving along. We also pray that you will be strengthened with his glorious power, so you will have all the endurance and patience, you need. May you be filled with joy, always thanking the Father. He has enabled you to share in the inheritance that belongs to his people who live in the light, for he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his dear Son, who purchased our freedom and forgave our sin. Well, the lordship of Jesus is comprehensive. It covers everything in our lives. When Jesus is Lord, you have all you need.
Amen.
Yeah, his lordship produces all the endurance. Amen. When you have to have patience and long suffering for some folk, his lordship enables you to handle difficult people.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
I'll just say this. When you come out from under his lordship, you can, amen, you can be a bad person.
Yeah. Yeah.
If Jesus is in government, you will give somebody a piece of your mind.
My Lord.
His lordship produces long suffering. Macrothumia, that's a Greek term. Patience,
yes.
Which is constancy and endurance you need. Oh, how we need patience and endurance.
Amen.
Is also his presence and his lordship produces joy.
Yes.
Amen. His lordship affords us the presence and power and ministry of Holy Spirit. And the fruit thereof. Amen. How many need joy every now and then?
Yes.
Yeah. The joy of the Lord is my
strength.
Yeah. Joy, unspeakable and full of glory, is what the scripture calls it. But the joy of the Lord is your strength. The joy is the way of empowering us.
Amen.
When the circumstances and situations can come and cause us, get us down, weigh us down, because they do. Amen. Yesterday, we could have been bogged down in sadness.
All right.
Not that sadness is not a part of life, but joy has a way of keeping you in the times when you're mourning.
Yes.
You can focus on God's goodness.
Amen.
Even though you're sad.
Yeah.
Giving thanks in the midst of it. Amen, amen. We're almost done. His lordship manifests the light we live in, which delivers us from the kingdom of darkness. Look, verse 13. Let's go back to verse 13. It said, for he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness. Don't ever forget, I was once lost.
Oh, yeah.
But now I'm found.
Thank you, Lord.
I was blind. But now I see.
Amen.
Don't ever forget where God brought you from. And his lordship was over that. His lordship, for he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and translated or transferred us into the kingdom of his dear son, who purchased our freedom and forgave us of our sins.
Yes.
Verse 15. Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. I'm pausing here for a reason, because if you want to know what God looks like, study Jesus. Mm-hmm. He said, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And I say that because how do we know him when we haven't put our natural eyes on him? Study the Word. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. Look at those words. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see.
All right.
Pay attention to what is next here. He made the things we see and the things we can't see. And Paul's reminding the church, and he's reminding us, he sees stuff we can't see.
Yeah.
And in this day and age when there's something wicked working around in our world, in our country, and in our state, wicked because there's darkness at work all the time. Now, say this with me. Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
God is sovereign.
Yes, God is sovereign.
And he's above all else.
And he's above all else.
I'm just reminding us, because we can look around and it seems like things are going to hell in a handbasket. Have you ever heard that?
Mm-hmm.
Now, things are getting worse and worse. Actually, Scripture says things will wax worse and worse. So if we keep our eyes and attention on that, it'll look like it's getting out of hand.
Huh.
We need to remind ourselves God is still sovereign.
Still God, Almighty.
Amen.
Amen.
Jesus is Lord. And it says here in verse 16, and I just want to remind us, let me read it. For through him God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. This is about our Lord. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see. Such as thrones. That means potentates, seats, earthly powers, dominions, kingdoms, governments, rulers, all of those folk. Kingdoms. That's government, rulers, and principalities and powers. And rulers, authorities, potentates, and jurisdictions. All of those things kind of blend in together. And it says authorities in the unseen world. Everything we can't see. All the things that we know are wicked in the world. The Lord says, I got them.
Yes.
Just so you know. How many know the devil? God said, I got him. And the scriptures say his time is running out. And the scriptures suggest that because his time is running out, he's getting more active. But remember, Jesus is what? Lord.
Yes, he is.
He's the Kyrios. He's the supreme authority. And who, where are we seated? And in Christ, at the right hand of the Father. We're seated in Christ. Everybody say in Christ.
In Christ.
If you're a child of God, you're in Christ and you're seated in him. And so you're seated in the Kyrios. The Lord. The supreme authority.
Yes.
And so you're covered by his divine power.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is God the Son. Jesus is Creator God. All authorities exist because of him. There. And here in verse. Did I read that? I didn't finish it up. That last phrase. Go back to verse 16, so I want us to read this and see. Since he's Lord and Kyrios, Let me read it. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him. And don't miss this letter. And for him.
All right.
Everything that's been created was created by him. King James says that. By him and for him. Put King James up there, if you don't mind. King James, there it is. All things were created by him and for him. So if you're worried about the devil is a creation from God.
Yes.
Now, he disobeyed God, but he's still under God's authority.
Amen.
Created by him and for him. I'm repeating that. So what does that afford us if Jesus is Lord? And all this stuff was created for him and by him. If we're in Christ, what do we have to worry about? Listen to God say, I got this.
My God.
He's telling you whatever you were, said, I got this. Everything you worried about, I've got it. Particularly the things in the unseen world. Thrones, dominions, or principalities, power, all these were created by him. For him. Verse 17. I'm almost done here. He existed before anything else, and he holds all creation together. This is Jesus, Lord. And Christ is also the head of the church.
Yes, he is.
Which is his body.
Thank you, Lord.
He is the beginning. Supreme over all who rise from the dead. So he is first in everything. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Listen to what the scriptures say. For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ. And through him God reconciled everything to himself.
Amen.
Amen. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross.
Yes.
Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we pay.
Yes.
All because we do not get. Y'all forgive me for being off key.
It's all right.
Everything to God.
In prayer.
In prayer.
Amen.
He made peace with everything in earth and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Jesus is Lord. Everybody say that with me. Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
Yes.
Thank when you say Jesus is Lord, that means he's more powerful than anything you worry about.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Yeah, verse 21, we're almost done. We're going to read the last three verses and we're done. This includes you who were once far away from God. I was there. You were his enemies, separated from him by your own evil thoughts and actions. Amen. And I like that scripture. It refers to my past. Yes. Sister Courtney. Yeah. I've been scripted, but it said, now, he's reconciled you.
Yes.
Amen. To himself. Through the death of Christ in his physical body.
Amen.
As a result, he has brought you into his own presence. And you are, oh, look at that word. Holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. Look at the power of your Lord.
Amen.
Amen. When you surrender to the Lordship of Christ Jesus, he said, I got you covered.
Amen. My God.
I got you covered. Everything everybody keeps accusing and reminding you and digging up on you, the Lord said, I got you.
Thank you, Father.
Verse 23. Okay. He said, I'm kind of encouraging you and I'm reminding you how favored you are and how much benefit you have in me. But he said, I'm going to put some onus on you. If you're expected to do something. Amen. That's for every one of us. He said, you must continue. You can't just sit down on this and be okay. I'm okay now. I'm in Christ. I can just sit here and wait until he comes.
No.
Amen. You must continue to believe this truth and stand firmly in it. This is Paul writing to the church, but it's for us. Don't drift away. Don't drift away from the assurance you received when you heard the good news. How many of you remember when you got saved? Oh, it changed everything.
Amen.
And Paul said, don't forget how that felt when you first got it. Yes. The good news has been preached all over the world, and I, Paul, have been appointed as God's servant to proclaim it. Amen. And he implies that you must carry that on yourself.
Amen.
Never forget, it's a gift. Amen. And you must continue to believe it and stand in it and don't drift away from it. Amen. It's the gift, I submit to you, that keeps on giving. Amen. God will give you the grace to stand in it and to walk in it. Amen. His lordship secures our future with God. That implies that as long as you continue in it, you got to stay in it.
Yes.
Amen. And he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you, so you're never alone.
Yes.
Amen. Stand with me. You're never alone. You're never alone if you're in Christ. He promised to never leave nor forsake you. His lordship assures you of that. He is God, and he's able to do more than you can imagine. If Jesus is Lord in your life, you don't have to worry about any other thing in this life.
My God.
There's nothing God hasn't seen. There's nothing God hasn't heard. Oh, it's amazing what the scriptures remind you of. He said, you can go to the darkest place in creation.
Yes.
The scripture said, you can go to hell.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't even fathom how this, but he said, I'm there.
Mm-hmm. My mind.
You know, I said that, but I know better than God is a transcendent God. That's a word that I say. There's no boundaries to him.
Thank you, Lord.
He's holy enough to walk into heaven and nothing touches him. Mm-hmm. Everything that exists, he spoke them into existence.
Yes.
My emphasis on him being able to be even in hell. He can go anywhere. He can go anywhere, but the thing is, the reality, there's no place that he is not. So take the limits off of God. If you think you're in a place that you're too far away from God to be rescued, I submit to you that God is right where you are.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
I've had some dark days of my own.
Oh, yeah.
That I don't want to argue with you is that mine are darker than yours. But I will submit to you that there is nothing too hard for God.
Amen.
So if you're hearing this message right now, God is letting you hear that I'm bigger than whatever you're facing.
Yes, he is. Thank you,
In
Father.
Fact, I'm right there.
Thank you, Jesus.
With you. Because you're hearing my word that says, I am Lord over everything. So wherever you are, whatever the challenge you're in, even in this sanctuary, if you're facing a difficult time in your life, the Lord says, I'm able to.
Yes, yes.
Amen. He can raise the dead. And he has raised the dead. He can make the crooked straight. He made an axe. Head flow. He can do what science says can't be done. He stopped the clock. He caused the sun and the moon to cooperate with his timetable. He walked on water. So there's nothing too hard for God. So I want to encourage you, because he is Lord, he's the Kyrios, he's the supreme authority. Here's what he says about his Lordship. And this is for each one of us, even the one who's farthest away from God, are those who are close to him and calls him Father and Lord. He says, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And I love the scriptures just gave us somewhat of an appreciation even this day that Lord, he is Lord. That means he's the supreme authority. There's nothing too hard for him. There's nothing he can't do. There's nothing that he can't overrule or change. Every head bowed. Two prayers. First and foremost for a soul, man, woman, boy, or girl that is here in the sanctuary or online will hear this message or tune in at this point. The gospel is still the good news. Jesus came to make things right between us and our Creator. God became one of us so that any of us can become like him.
Yes.
And so, Lord, we stand with the soul, the man, woman, boy, and girl that's hearing your call for themselves. Your word says if they call on your name, they will be saved. And believe in their heart that you are Lord. You're God who came down to save sinners and make their relationship right with you by your death, your burial, and your resurrection. You said if we believe that, right standing salvation is ours. So let the man, woman, boy, or girl who's hearing us today say, Lord, I believe. Spirit, we ask that you will do what only you can do. Stir their hearts to cry out, reach out to the Powerhouse Church of God or anybody of believers that teach and preach the word of God that love on you, even their family members. Let them reach out and say, I call on the name of the Lord today. And put them in a good body of believers so that they can grow in their faith, we pray. Father, for those of us standing here and those that are looking in, we pray, oh God, that your Lordship will ever increase in our lives. touch every area of our lives, our minds, our bodies, our families, our relationships, our marriages, our finances. You are Lord over everything. We commit to it,
God,
so that we can live out our faith today to the end, that the light of the gospel shines through every area of our lives. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
We give you thanks. We give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. God bless you. God keep you. And we say thank you for tuning in with us today. We speak His Lordship over your lives, and we will see you next time.